Hi, I'm Tamara, and this is TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Hi, everyone. Today, I'm speaking with Eliza Reid. Eliza is Canadian-born and raised just outside of Ottawa, and she's now the First Lady of Iceland. She's been calling Iceland home for the last 19 years. She's a freelance writer. She started a writing retreat in Iceland, and her new book is called Secrets of the Sprakkar. What does Sprakkar mean? You'll find out. Here's Eliza. It's so good to see you. Hi.
Hi, thanks for inviting me.
So I have never spoken to the First Lady of Iceland before. What do I call you?
Just call me Eliza. We're all on a first name basis here in Iceland.
Eliza. Okay. And Eliza, you are Canadian. You're from here. Well, from outside of Ottawa. And yet somehow you ended up in Iceland and you are now married to the president of Iceland, right?
That's absolutely correct. So who would have thunk it, as they say?
I can't even, it's such a story. So please tell us how you met your husband. How did this all happen?
Yeah. I guess the end result is kind of unusual, although the story itself maybe isn't all that unusual. I grew up, as you say, on a hobby farm just outside of Ottawa. And I went to university in Toronto, didn't know what I wanted to do. So I moved to England to go to graduate school at Oxford University, where Canadians were a dime a dozen. But there was one man from Iceland there, and he was the only Icelander at the college that we were studying at Oxford. So that made him very exotic. And we met and fell in love and moved to Iceland. And I've lived now in Iceland for almost 19 years.
Wow. Now, I remember when your husband became president because it was, well, because you were the story too here in Canada. Because, well, you were, right? It was like, just all of a sudden it was like, oh, and a Canadian is the president's wife. And it was like, wait, what? How did that happen? And so that was curious. But also, your husband had an interesting road or path, if you will, to the presidency. It's unusual, isn't it?
And rapid is, I guess, the main adjective for him, because as a tiny backgrounder for those who may not be familiar with the ins and outs of Icelandic politics, but Iceland has both a president and a prime minister. So the president is a little bit more like Canada's governor general. It's the head of state, but he's not a member of a political party and doesn't have a political platform. So the fact that he hadn't been in politics before or run for office was not maybe as unusual as you might think. But he was a history professor and an expert on the presidency of Iceland, the Icelandic constitution, Icelandic political history. And in 2016, there was a scheduled presidential election at the end of June. The outgoing president had announced he wasn't going to run again. And the Panama Papers scandal broke at the beginning of April, which implicated the prime minister of Iceland. But it was huge news here. And so they called pundits, neutral pundits, onto the news, onto TV to talk about, you know, what was happening. And my husband was called up. And because there was this ongoing presidential election and people all of a sudden realized that the president does need to know the ins and outs of the constitution and what you can do when there's a political crisis like this one, he just seemed to people to be the right person at the right time. And people literally started calling our house and saying, have you thought about running for president? We really think you should run. And this was in April. And so the election was at the end of June and he won. So it was that rapid of, it was really unbelievable. I remember.
So can you, I'm not very good at pronouncing very many things in Iceland. So your husband's name is?
Well, I just say Gudni Johannesson.
Gudni Johannesson. Okay.
Yes.
Gudni.
And we'll call him Gudni because we're all on first names here.
So. Gudni. Now, when I was reading about Gudni, I saw like his approval rating is like at one point it was 97%.
I know. Believe me.
This seems...
I try to keep him grounded at home.
Well, yes. And I mean, I know that it's, you know, it's a totally different system to learn for somebody here in North America. But I mean, everything here, it seems, is so polarizing when it comes to anything to do with government. And then I read about Gundy having 97% approval ratings. Like, wait a minute, maybe I do want to move to Iceland.
And he's 100% with me.
Yes, of course.
So you're talking to someone who's very biased, obviously. I know. We're just, you know, I think the office of the president has a lot of respect associated with it here. And again, it's kind of a neutral office really meant to unite the country. So in a sense, you really don't have the same kind of controversial things. You know, you don't, you're not saying we are prioritizing education over healthcare or vice versa. So by nature of that fact, you would tend to maybe have higher approval ratings than a prime minister might, for example. But he's a good guy. I mean, you know, again, I'm utterly biased, so you can't ask me what the secret sauce is. But I think he wants to serve the country with honor and dignity and make sure people have their voices heard, and he is doing it in a kind of selfless way, and that appeals to people.
So what does this mean for you, though, Eliza? Like, what? How do you see your role? Like you said, you've been in Iceland now for 19 years. You have 4 children, right?
And we do, and I have an adult stepdaughter too.
There you go. So big family. And you know, when it said that you're the first lady of Iceland, or you know, we have our own ideas of how things are. What is your role in Iceland, what path have you sort of made for yourself?
I mean, that's a great question, Tamara, because, you know, going back to what the short time span was from being Eliza, who's a freelance writer and editor, to Eliza being married to the head of state was pretty quick. And there is no job description for the spouse of the head of state because it isn't really a formal role. You know, I haven't been elected to anything and I don't have a salary. And yet there are kind of expectations, especially I think for women, of accompanying the spouse on a state visit or greeting heads of state when they come or being there for certain occasions. And you know, traditionally, I think that was very much seen as kind of the hostess role in a capacity. And I feel like I'm in such a privileged position to be able to serve the country in this way. And I enjoy it very much. But I was kind of nervous at first because I thought, you know, I'm a rule follower. And I thought, well, am I allowed to do this? Am I allowed to do that? Do I have to do this? Do I have to do that? And I wanted to serve with honor and with dignity, but I also wanted to use my voice because all of a sudden I had built up a life for myself in Iceland. I had moved here because of my husband. I moved here for love, but I really wanted to stay here for me. So I had my own job and my own, you know, fulfilling projects professionally. And all of a sudden then I was known as somebody's wife. And it kind of diminishes one's own identity a little bit, even though, of course, I'm very proud to be Gudni's wife. So I thought, well, maybe what I should be doing is speaking up and using my voice because I do have this platform now. And if there is no rule book, then I can't break the rules. So I'll just, you know, be myself and be who I want to be. And part of that is exploring this idea of sort of gendered expectations of what we expect, especially of female spouses of male heads of state. And so I thought, I don't know that I really consciously thought about it this way, but I gradually started doing things that I hope confounded those expectations. So I did a lot of speeches myself, or I didn't go with my husband to every possible event where he could go with someone. Although I did if I wanted to, because I get to choose what I want to do. But I try to say, talk about entrepreneurship and innovation and maybe less kind of stereotypical feminine projects. So, and try to be vocal. And part of that is writing this book that I wrote, Secrets of the Sprakkar, because it's all about gender equality and it's all about kind of making the most of unexpected opportunity and using our voices.
Mm-hmm. It's so fascinating because you're right. We always see women, not only with heads of state, but in so many roles, even in the business world, right? Where the wife comes along to the, you know, the dinner or the boardroom party or whatever it might be, and then that's it. And And, you know, you're at home and you're doing your home stuff, what women do. And it's such an interesting conversation because I remember reading about how, you know, in order to be a successful woman in business, you would have to have a husband at home who is cool with 50% of the work.
Right. The mental load, right? I think that's, yes. You know, we see now people talking about men, oh, I do the dishes at least 50% of the time or not, but who is remembering to do the dishes and who is remembering when the kids have soccer practice or when it's so-and-so's birthday or all of that, you know, being the household CEO. And I think that's a really important thing to think about. But, you know, you're absolutely right when you talk about being the spouse at the dinner party or something else. And while maybe not a lot of people end up married to heads of state, a lot of people, and especially women, know what it's like to be married to someone who is kind of better known than they are themselves. And you go to the dinner party and people don't talk to you, or people only talk to you about something to do with your spouse rather than your own events.
Or they think that they already have decided who you are and what your role in life is, right?
Absolutely.
I find it interesting, and I'm sure it's the same way where you are, is sometimes when you go to these, you know, gatherings or whatever, the first thing, and I do it myself, the first thing somebody says to you is, oh, so what do you do? What do you do? What do you do? What do you do? Where do you work? Where do you work? Where do you work? And, you know, I mean, things have changed, especially, I haven't been out in, you know, a couple of years now, so I don't have to have those conversations. But it is very interesting how we navigate those conversations socially when it comes to women and our roles in, So gender equality in Iceland, I've read quite a few things about this, and it's very surprising. I have to say, I was surprised that you are, your country is such a leader when it comes to.
Why were you surprised?
I don't know. Yeah. I just never.
I'm an interviewee.
I know, right? Here we go. Two journalists talking to each other. This is great. A couple of things, Eliza. I'll tell you why. I've always been intrigued by Iceland for obvious reasons. Once I saw how beautiful it was in pictures and, you know, through social media, and you see all the, and I was like, I want to go there. And I've thought this for years somewhere. I love that part of the world and I'm very intrigued by it. And I would love to see it with my own eyes one day. And so I started reading a little bit more and I never really considered, gender equality never crossed my mind as something that Iceland would be known for. And I have no reason to think that other than it just never crossed my mind. And maybe that's the problem, that it never crossed my mind for any country. I would think that it would have to be this big, fancy, you know, millions and millions and millions of people that would do it, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, that's, you know, that's an excellent point. And I think it's one of the sparks really for why I wrote the book, because so Iceland, by other standards, is quote unquote the best country in the world for women. It's topped the World Economic Forum's Global Gender Equality Index for the past 12 years. So, you know, objectively speaking, it's not saying it's a gender paradise, but it's doing pretty well on those matrices that the World Economic Forum measures. And everybody here is very proud of that. And they're very proud, for instance, of the fact that we had the first female president in the world, who was president from 1980 to 1996. And I think, if I put my Canadian's hat on as well, you know how sometimes when we see a Canadian in the news abroad and we'll say, oh, she's Canadian or he's Canadian. And it's like, we all know who's Canadian. We have to tell everybody else about it. It's our sort of small nation insecurity. And, you know, Iceland is the same. We want everybody to know about everything great that we've done. And yet not everybody knows that. So I remember, you know, if you'd said that to somebody maybe who was born in Iceland, the person might say, oh, but they must know that we had the first president in the world. And I'd say, actually, I don't think it is that well known that Iceland had the first female president in the world. And actually, you know, that we had the first openly lesbian head of government. I don't think everybody knows that. And that was kind of part of the reason why I had this idea to write the book, because I thought, Well, if people don't know these role models that we've had and they don't know that we're doing well on these indices, I just want to paint a portrait of a country that is farthest along this journey and what it's like to be a woman in this country. And that's kind of how I wrote the book, by speaking to people around the country. And not, you know, the first president and the first lesbian prime minister and the first to do this or that, but just regular women and regular people doing jobs. And what does it mean to be in this country if you are a writer or if you are a politician or if you are a sex counselor or a comedian or, you know, a business person? And those are the stories that I wanted to tell.
Mm-hmm. So let's talk about Secrets of the Sprakkar.
Yes, perfect.
Did I say it right? I love it.
You did. And so maybe I should start by telling you what that word means.
Please. That was going to be my first question.
I didn't mean to jump the gun there. Sprakkar is an Icelandic word, obviously, that means extraordinary women. It's the plural of the word Sprakki. It's very obscure. Nobody in Iceland knew it.
Wow.
And I just love this word because if you think about it in English, how many words do we have in English that describe only women that are positive? Go ahead.
Yeah.
That's when you do the fast forward time, you know,
exactly.
You see time flashes forward. We're still
Sprakkar.
Thinking. There aren't any.
Wow. I love this word.
So it's a great word. And I hope I can kind of introduce it into the English language a little bit. Yeah. Sprakkar.
So what is it like to be a woman in Iceland?
I think it's great. I mean, I've been here most of my adult life now as well. And hopefully this is a country where there are societal supports that encourage healthy work-life balance. So there's very good parental leave policies. There's very good and affordable childcare. There are also policies that try to encourage more people, more women in the workplace, like gender quotas for the boards of publicly traded companies. But it goes beyond policies. It's also about a society where we're trying to work to encourage a diversity of voices. So, and a lot of that has to do with visible role models. So, you know, we have a female prime minister, we have a female bishop of the national church and chief medical officer. And we know how important chief medical officers are these days. And seeing those people in these positions of responsibility is very important. And I'm also trying to tell the story of different women who are using their voices and taking up space. You know, so I interview a group of women called the Jellyfish, who are women around the age of 50, seven of them, who a couple of years ago decided they would swim across the English Channel to raise money for charity. And they just wanted to set a really tough physical challenge for themselves. And so I went swimming. They go swimming every week on this in this beach, in the sea in Reykjavik. And Reykjavik is the world's northernmost capital city. So it's pretty cold in the North Atlantic here. And they go out for a little swim every week. And so in the name of research, I went and swam with them. And when I say swam, I waded into the water, went down to my neck, screamed and swore, and then ran out. And they actually swam. But these women, you know, were saying, you know, how does this have to do with gender equality? They said, you know, we are taking up space for ourselves. And when men say, oh, I'm going golfing with the guys this weekend, and apologies to men who are listening out there. I know that men don't talk in that tone of voice all the time. And they said, I'm going golf. Nobody questions that. That's their sort of bonding time together. And they said, you know, we're going to do this amazing challenge. We have to train for it. We're going to raise money for charity. And people said, what does your husband think about that? But what about the kids? You know, are you allowed to do that? And you know, it's really important to have those kind of role models as well.
Wow. I love that. So you, I mean, you're a writer. This is who you are in your, you know, your core. You are, you know, a reporter, writer. You're a curious person. So to be able to you know, write this book as a gift to the rest of the world to show us just how it's done, really, what's happening in your country. You started a writer's retreat.
I did.
Yeah. So I'm very curious about writer's retreats. I've been on quite a few of them in the past. And okay. But more close to where I am, like not flying to Iceland and having a writer's retreat there. It sounds incredible. Tell me why you started a writer's retreat.
Well, I mean, the short answer is wine, or, you know, all the best ideas happen over some wine. My friend and I, who started it, were drinking a little bit of wine one evening, and she'd just gone to a writer's retreat, and she had this great time. And Reykjavik, Iceland's capital, is the world's first non-native English-speaking UNESCO city of literature. So there's this really strong literary heritage in Iceland. And we're really proud of our authors here. We have a Nobel Prize winning author. We wrote the Icelandic sagas. And I remember we were talking, we said, how come there isn't an event for writers in Iceland? Because this is the writer's paradise. And the, you know, the environment is inspirational. And even if the weather is bad, you can be inside writing. It's fantastic. So we just decided to do that. And it's a very social writer's retreat. It's, you know, we thought conference was sort of corporate sounding, but it's not. There's a lot of mingling for people who want to do that. And we have authors from around the world who come over and lead small group writing workshops. So you can be with, you know, Meg Wolitzer or Miriam Taves or Madeline Tien. And there's sort of 5 to 15 people in the class, and you're talking for a couple of hours. And then we go on a literary walking tour of Reykjavik, and we have a day tour in the Icelandic countryside that's led by a local writer who stops and does a reading on the way. And so there's kind of this mixture of tourism and writing, and everybody can go. So you don't have to audition, and there aren't classes on how to sell your book or any of the sort of practicalities. It's more about the love of the craft. And then this year we're doing one for readers too, called the Iceland Readers Retreat. So for people who just love reading and like to meet authors but don't want to write, they can come and meet all the authors and hear them read. But then instead of doing the writing workshops, they'll do other tours and they'll see the Icelandic sagas, the real manuscripts. And so it's a lot of fun.
Yeah, no kidding. It sounds like a dream, really. And such a beautiful place to do it too. You know, a cup of tea and a book and... Yes, exactly.
I'm drinking more tea right exactly. now. I hope nobody knows how informal.
So one of the things we do, Eliza, is on this podcast is we like to thank people for spending their time and coming here. And we give back to a Canadian nonprofit. We ask our guests to choose a Canadian nonprofit organization. We give them $500 in your name. You chose the Elizabeth Fry Society of Ottawa, which supports and advocates for young and adult women in the community who are criminalized or may become criminalized. Is there a reason why you chose the Elizabeth Fry Society of Ottawa?
I chose the Elizabeth Fry Society of Ottawa because Ottawa is my hometown. Yeah. So I wanted to support something from my hometown. And Elizabeth Fry Society, simply because of the great work that they're doing all over, again, to support marginalized women. And I thought, given that I was on this program to speak to you about gender equality in women, I thought it was obvious, or as we would say in Icelandic, it lies in the eyes upstairs, which means it's obvious, that I should do something to support organizations for women.
Thank you. Well, we'll be giving them $500 on your behalf. So thank you very much for that. When you look at Iceland, how would you describe it to, say, somebody back home here, you know, in your old hometown who's never been? How would you describe Iceland now that you've been there and it's your new home? How would you describe it to someone?
I would say that I would encourage them to come and visit. The air is pristine and clear and beautiful. That it, as a Canadian, it's definitely not as cold as they might think that it is. It's much warmer than most places in Canada in the winter, but much colder in the summer than everywhere else. That the food is wonderful. I love eating good food, and there's amazing fresh food here all the time. And really down to earth, straightforward people, you know, good people. This island has volcanoes and earthquakes and not many trees. And like Canada, you know, we know that ultimately nature rules, but that also means that we really help each other out in times of crisis. So there's kind of this independent streak where you will do your own thing. It's not a terribly chivalrous nation, I would say, but when push comes to shove, you know, you can do anything you need to. So I remember once when I was really heavily pregnant with my second child, pushing a stroller, and I was trying to get the stroller down the stairs with my baby then. And then I had this huge belly, and nobody offered to like carry the stroller or help me with it. But then of course I turned to someone and I asked, and that was no problem. You know, it's not the kind of place where doors are open for you right away, but the search and rescue crew here is entirely volunteer run. And these are people, you know, if your car gets stuck somewhere, or if you get in trouble in bad weather or get lost, volunteers will just come and they will, you know, literally scale down cliffs or jump into the sea or do what they need to do to help you out. And if you're in the countryside and your car breaks down or something, someone will immediately stop to help you. The first person to come by. And so that sort of warmth and compassion really encompasses us.
What, how's the pandemic been? I mean, that's a loaded question. So let me rephrase that. You know, being on an island, the pandemic's been horrible for everybody. So that's the answer to that. But, you know, being on an island, and you're a small country. And, you know, I feel like at the beginning of the pandemic, we all kind of knew what everybody else was doing, you know, watching the news all the time, that now we're sort of in the thick of it. And it's really hard to see past what's happening in our own city right now, because it's just been so stressful. But what has the experience been like for you and your neighbors?
I've been very grateful to be in Iceland during the pandemic. I think we have excellent officials from the outset. It's really been led by the scientists. So when the pandemic first happened, the chief medical officer, the chief epidemiologist, and the sort of head of the police security area did daily press briefings without, so there was no politicians at all, unless some kind of new law was being introduced somewhere else. So it wasn't politicized in any way. And, you know, everybody was tuning in, and there was a real sort of sense of solidarity and that we're all in this together. And there's really, really high vaccination uptake rates, and it's incredibly efficient. So, you know, in the first waves, if you got COVID, you know, you'd get a PCR test, you'd find out the same day. If you had COVID, you would get a call every day from a health official to ask you how you were feeling and if you were feeling any worse or feeling any better. And even now, when there's a lot more cases, for example, my son just got COVID, and he was, you know, he's all vaccinated and very mild case, but he has his PCR test right away, gets a text message explaining exactly what he should be doing. He gets a phone call from the health services asking him how he's feeling, and then an online test that you fill in every day saying, are you feeling stressed by the situation or the fact that you're in isolation? And they, you know, they follow up with everybody regularly, and then everybody in the family goes for PCR tests to make sure that you are allowed to go out. And then you get a text when you've graduated that you can leave again. So you kind of feel very well taken care of, and you know that if you were feeling concerned, you know, because of the situation, or you did get worse, that you have somewhere that you can call and someone that you can talk to.
And so is it going to be okay for the writer's retreat coming up in the spring? Will we be able to come to thumbs up?
I mean, yeah, okay, if there's a pandemic, so obviously nobody knows anything, but it is absolutely our plan to host an in-person event. And we believe that we can do that, you know, while adhering to all of the strict health and safety regulations here. And I suppose for people who are interested in attending, those have to do with the fact that you obviously have to show a negative test to come into Iceland. And, you know, it's a very, very high vaccination rate here. And they're hoping, I think, by that time that there will be very few regulations within Iceland in terms of groups. And they're kind of gradually opening that up. But obviously we're following it and, you know, doing our best. But people want to travel again
boy.
Safely, obviously.
Yes, yeah.
People are ready.
People are ready. Yeah. It's but we have a lot more work to do still when it comes to, you know, getting a handle on this virus. But yeah, I mean, so, okay, Iceland, it's on my list, definitely, like at the top of my list. What is the best time of year to come to Iceland? I know it's, and any time is a good time, Eliza. I know that. But if I like have to choose,
I'm a public official.
Okay. If I have to, I can, it's a long trip, right? I want to see the country. I want to see it all. I want to experience it. I want to, you know.
I'm going to tell you a couple of things because I am, you know, a representative for the country unofficially, obviously. So first of all, it's not really that long of a trip. If you are in Vancouver, it's a 7-hour flight because we go over the north. I know. Yes. If you're in Toronto, it's just as quick, if not quicker, than flying to Vancouver. So it's much closer than you think. And it depends on what you want to do, because if you want 24-hour daylight and the opportunity to travel, you can come in July and it'll never get dark and you can drive around the country. If you want to sit in a hot spring and see the northern lights, then you can go in the wintertime when it gets dark. If you want to go in the fall, you can come for a literature festival or a music festival, or you can go for a food festival in February. And of course, I'm going to give you that answer where like there's no time, it's a bad time to visit Iceland, right?
Yeah, I love it. I love it. Okay, so secrets of the Sprakkar. And that word again means?
Outstanding women. And so the subtitle of the book is Iceland's Outstanding Women and How They Are Changing the World.
It's available now wherever you buy your book, your favorite books, online or in your bookstore. You can get Secrets of the Sprakkar, and you can follow Eliza online. She's on Instagram at Eliza, that's E-L-I-Z-A, Jean, J-E-A-N, Reid, R-E-I-D. So that's at Eliza Jane Reid. She's also on Twitter at Eliza J. Reid, or just go to her website and just Google her name like I did. There's lots about Eliza there. Eliza, it's been so wonderful talking to you. I really have enjoyed this conversation a lot. An unexpected conversation about a great book, a tiny country that's leading the way, and somewhere I've always wanted to visit. So you've added some fuel to my dreams. So thank you so much for this great conversation.
My pleasure. Thank you for inviting me on your show.
Thanks for listening to another episode of TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Be sure to subscribe so you can join us every Tuesday for another conversation. You can also check out our website, telus.com/podcast, and subscribe to our YouTube channel at TELUS Talks.